Tom Ford, meteoric rise at the House of Gucci has been one of the great success stories of the decade. Since the 1930s, Gucci has been known for their signature loafers and leather bags. But by the 1980s, the designs were stuffy and bordering on gaudy, and the Gucci empire was crumbling. Ford came on board in 1990 as a then unknown designer from Perry Ellis, just as Gucci was on the verge of bankruptcy. Since taking over as creative director, his modernized retro designs have single-handedly doubled the company's stock and generate sales of over $1 billion a year, making it the driving force in fashion today. I am pleased to have Tom Ford on this broadcast for a look at his career and what is happening in the world of fashion. Welcome to the program.
Thank you.
It's great to have you here.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
Wanted to do this for a while.
Thank you. I've wanted to do it for a while.
Well, this would work out just fine. Tell me where Gucci is in terms of, you've just acquired Yves Saint Laurent.
We have.
You know, the haute couture is going to sort of stay over
haute
there.
Haute couture has stayed, excuse me, haute couture stayed a part of another company called Artemis, which is held by Francois Pinault. Yeah. So that's a separate company at this point. And we've acquired everything else that really is Yves Saint Laurent. Along with Yves Saint Laurent, there's a big part of the business, which is Sanofi Beauté, yeah. Which used to be a part of Sanofi, which is a pharmaceuticals company in France. And they're really two separate businesses. There's the fashion business, and there's Sanofi Beauté, which is a fragrance and cosmetics business, which the sort of primary or most important brand at Sanofi is Yves Saint Laurent.
What does this mean for you and for Gucci?
What does it mean? It means we've started our multi-brand, started implementing our multi-brand strategy. It's been our goal for really the past few years, although this was sort of accelerated about a year ago. To become a multi-brand luxury goods group. And Saint Laurent and Sanofi is our first acquisition. We followed right after that, the week right after, with another company called Sergio Rossi, which is a great shoe company, an Italian shoe company, that does quite well and we believe has a lot of potential.
You led me right where I wanted to go. There are those who say that you might want to buy Versace. There are those who say you might want to buy Calvin Klein.
You know, you can't believe rumors in this business. It's amazing. You know, we were just talking before we went on air about Stella McCartney, who's a friend of mine. And, you know, yeah. We've been spotted out a few times. And the next thing you know, Stella McCartney's coming to Gucci. I mean, the fashion business, well, I guess all businesses today, really. You know, it's hard to stay out of the press. People watch you so, you know, with a microscope. So there are a lot of rumors around.
Okay.
We are obviously looking at other acquisitions. We have nothing to announce this moment, and we've made no final decisions on other companies.
Okay, so it's a possibility.
That's a diplomatic answer.
Yeah, I know. I want to get around. I want to massage the answer a little bit.
Right.
It's a possibility you could be looking at Calvin Klein. It would fit in the Gucci empire.
You know, we're looking at a lot of things.
And Versace would fit in the same category.
We're looking at a lot of
things. Those
that
you might be looking at.
Looking at a lot of things. You know, what we try to look at when we look for a company, we try to add value. So we look for companies where we believe that our expertise could enhance the value of that company and thus enhance the value of Gucci Group. And that could mean different things. You know, a company could be lacking, you know, could be like Gucci. Yeah. It could be a great name that is sort of sleeping, and needs to be re-energized. Could be a place where you have an amazing designer who's doing a great, you know, progressing nicely but needs an infusion of capital. And maybe a little bit of direction in terms of stores and merchandising, and we can add that. So there are different scenarios and different types of things that we're looking at.
All right, let me stay along this line. So if you acquired Chloe, mm-hmm. you'd acquire Stella. And then the idea is this. Stella would come over and do all the designing for Gucci.
You're jumping way ahead. First of all, Chloe's part of a big luxury goods group on its own, and
right.
we're not acquiring Chloe, and we're not, you know, blah, blah, blah.
Or Stella could come to Gucci, and then you could go over to YSL.
Well, that's the thing about fashion today, you know, it's changed. Designers have been hopping around recently, and designers are becoming more and more like actors, in a sense. And if you want a hit, you get the hit designer, and you bring the hit designer here, and
right.
if that doesn't work, the hit designer goes there. And the stock of the place where the designer is can rise and fall with, you know, it's changing. I mean, the fashion business is changing.
How is it changing?
Well, there are more designers, for example, who are willing and who want to design for a larger house and who don't necessarily want their name on the label. It has been a...
You're a perfect example of that.
And it was a decision that I made. I don't want my name on a label. One day, I want to be able to walk away and say, you know what, this has been wonderful. I loved designing, but I want to go make a movie, or I want to go live in New Mexico and drive a pickup truck and try to be a sculptor, or I don't know. I mean, there are lots of things I might want to do in my life.
But so what you don't want to do is drive down Sunset Boulevard and look up to a billboard. There is a picture of you with a product that you had nothing to do.
No, I don't, and I don't want to be tied to that. Also, had I started off on my own 5 years ago, we would not be, and I would not be where I am today, because when you're working with a company that already exists, we have a distribution network set up. You know, 5 years ago, Gucci, we had 168 stores. You change the design, and boom, 6 months later, it's in 168 stores. If you're just starting as a designer, it takes time to build up that distribution. It takes time to, you know, I mean, there are lots of things to consider about that. So you can go quicker, I think, if you're re-energizing an existing house.
Okay, well, let's stay with you since you mentioned that idea.
Also, the brand recognition is already there in the consumer's head. And that's another thing, that it takes a long time to build up an image in the consumer's mind of recognizing a name and associating things with that name. And again, with an existing name, that's quicker and easier to accomplish.
I let you slip away with Stella McCartney. Is she going to, you want to work with her?
I would love to slip away with Stella McCartney, as would most men I know who meet Stella McCartney.
Yes. Anyway. Would you like to have her working with you?
I love Stella.
Would she be great to run the Gucci design?
I think that Stella, first of all, that rumor makes no sense, because Stella, as we all know, does not design in leather or fur, and Gucci is a leather house.
That's right.
Well, it's also
part of
her upbringing.
You could spend the leather stuff off.
We could. See, you've been talking. Anyway, but Stella has everything, I think, that it takes to make a designer today. I think she's an excellent designer. I think she's got great sense of style, great taste. But she also has everything else. She has the drive, she has the will, she has the intelligence. She worries about sales. She thinks about the brand as a brand. She's also got incredible charm. She's beautiful. All those things are important today. You know, more and more we're a visual society, and what you look like and how you photograph and what you, how you spin things, and that sounds like a cynical thing to say, is equally important, or not equally, but is part of the thing. The most important thing is still the product.
Okay, but some say it is the fact that you understood what you just said that has enabled you, in part, one of the factors that enabled you to turn around Gucci in design. You understood image, you understood story, you understood how I present things, how I relate to the media, the power of television, all of that.
Well, you have to. I mean, it is today's world. You have to. And while I said that the most important thing is the product, and that really is true, because you can have all the advertising in the world, you can have all the hype, and when people go to the store, if they try on your pants and they don't look good and they don't fit or they don't like the fabric, they're not going to buy them. But to get them into the store, to get them there, you need the other part of the equation. You need to excite them, and you need, you know, pants are pants. I mean, fashion, you know, one pair of black pants and the other pair of black pants, you know. So you have to make fashion aspirational. You have to make people believe that if they just have those pants, their whole life is going to come together. They're going to get that guy they want. They're going to get that new job. They're going to get, you know, it's right. Because, and that's just as much as a part of the experience. And it actually, again, that sounds like a terrible, very calculated thing, but it's not, because by creating that image, you have endowed another quality onto that pair of pants or pair of shoes. That really, you know, makes it something else and makes your experience of wearing that thing something else and enhances your life.
If it all gives you confidence to bring out the best in you,
that's the word.
If it gives you the confidence to bring out the best in you, then it's contributed to your well-being.
Absolutely.
Right. The business is changing. Part of it is this power of image that it's a part of it today. How else is it changing? I mean, is it changing in color? Is it changing in where the designs are coming from? Is it changing in terms of the power of certain kinds of forces?
It's changing in every way, and I hope, because it's about to change again. I mean, it changes constantly, fashion. It changes as life changes, and real, true changes in fashion are linked to changes in life. Otherwise, you know, they don't really mean anything. And life is changing dramatically. I mean, we're on, you know, we were just looking at your cell phone and your Palm Pilot and your two cell phones and your, you know, I mean, but life is changing. Yeah. And we're working more and more at home, more and more from our computer screen, which in the future, I mean, there's several ways this could go. A lot of people think fashion might just die because we're just at home. You can be working in your underwear and a T-shirt. Who cares who's going to see you? You know, even if, when we do become all visually linked through teleconferencing, which I use a lot to work now and to design, you know, you're just seeing this much of somebody. But that means that when you go out in the real world, you're almost making a public appearance, just as an actor or an actress would. And you might want to go to different lengths, you know. So a friend of mine who's the wife of a, and I say this all the time, but it's so true and I thought it made so much sense. A friend of mine who's a wife of a Hollywood actor, a very famous actor, said she doesn't need anything anymore but you know, jeans, T-shirts, and ball gowns. Because either she's working and she's in jeans and a T-shirt, or she's stepping out somewhere and waving to people and smiling and getting out of a car or being photographed or something. Now, you might think, well, yeah, but she's the wife of a famous actor. She's an actress in her own right. But real people are becoming more like this. You know, more and more, even if you're meeting someone on the internet, if you're going to really arrange a meeting, you want to look great. You know, you're not going to go. You're going to make an effort. So there's so many ways that I mean, I don't know how fashion will change in the next 10 years. I, you know, it will move and change quickly, more and more quickly.
Is it as satisfying for you today as it has been as you've been on this sort of meteoric rise in terms of transforming Gucci and all the things you've had to do there? Mm. Is it still satisfying?
Absolutely. It's more satisfying than ever. And once I really realized that, I mean, that's the key to happiness is loving what you do. And two or three years ago, you know, for the last 10 years of my life, I wanted to be a successful fashion designer, and I wanted to have, you know, a hit show and another hit show and a strong business and blah, 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 and all these things that you want in life. And I had them. And I became a little bit depressed for, you know, 6 months. I thought, well, you know, is this it? Is this it? And what am I going to do to sort of get my energy back and to become excited about this again? And it dawned on me one day that I really love what I do, and that it's not about money, it's not about you know, all these other things. It's because I love this. It's something that comes naturally to me. You know, if you leave me alone here long enough, Charlie, I will refinish your table, change the color.
You're our guy.
Yeah, you know, we need.
You're the guy we
need.
I'll
start. I mean, it's just something I do, and I love that process. I love that process, yeah. Whether I, you know, I'm doing it for a company like Gucci or whether I'm doing it in my personal life. It's what I love. Yeah. And
you may be, have been enormously lucky because
I've been very lucky.
Of course, what happened at Gucci. Let me just trace your own. I mean, you grew up in Austin, Texas, mm-hmm. then moved to
Santa Fe, New Mexico, where I lived most of my childhood. Yeah.
And then came to, first went to Hollywood?
Well, no, I went to New York. I moved to New York when I was 17. I went to NYU, and I was studying art history. And I dropped out of school because I started making television commercials.
As an actor?
As an actor. Well, you know, an actor. Yeah, I was doing television commercials, you know, I was sort of selling things. Did that for 3 or 4 years. I worked quite a lot and moved to Los Angeles during that period of time, and then decided that I didn't want to be an actor. I didn't like it. I wanted to be on the other side of whatever the, you know, creative thing was, and went back to school and started studying interior architecture at Parsons, moved back to New York, and then moved to New York, and I mean, moved to Paris. And I went to school for a year and a half in Paris. While I was in Paris, I had an internship at Chloe, actually, in the press department, and decided that fashion actually was what really interested me. Architecture was way too serious, and I was never going to have the patience to wait, you know, 2 years for a building to be built, and decided to go into fashion. Moved back to New York and got a job.
How'd you get the job?
Driving people crazy, you know, yes. Calling them constantly, calling them. I put together a book. I didn't have any fashion experience. I drew up a portfolio of things I thought were the right things, targeted people I wanted to work for, and I just called and called.
And once you got a job. Call and she said, come on up, and you were in the lobby and you were up in 2 seconds.
Kathy Hardwick. I see you've been talking to Kathy, yeah.
And that worked out.
It did.
And then you went to Perry Ellis.
I was at Kathy Hardwick for about 2 years, and then I went to Perry Ellis, and I was there, I think, for about 2 years as well. It's hard to remember now. And then moved to Italy and started working at Gucci. I realized that I wanted to move to Europe because at that time, fashion wasn't as global as it has become now.
It was centered in Europe?
Well, It is still, to a certain extent, centered in Europe, although less and less so. I mean, really becoming more and more global. But I realized that I didn't think it would be any harder to make it as a fashion designer in Europe than it would be in America. And if you made it in Europe, you were instantly globally marketable. And that attracted me. And so I realized I wanted to go to Europe and work in fashion in Europe. And I did that in 1990.
Who brought you to Gucci?
Don Mello, a mutual friend of ours, who's a wonderful woman and a great friend. And not only did she bring me to Gucci, she taught me a lot. And working with her for 4 years, I think, was one of the, I mean, really has helped me incredibly.
Which brought me to this point, it seems to me, that you can really luck out if you're at a place where, because things are changing, where you're under siege, where there is a tottering possibility of bankruptcy, and they don't have a lot of designers around,
totally.
And you have to do everything.
Yeah.
And if you do everything, and if you're alert, and if you work 24 hours a day, you get a hands-on experience that will provide extraordinary exponential benefits.
So much
down
of
the road.
It is luck. It really is luck, because when InvestCorp...
Well, preparation meets luck.
Well, you have to be ready to take... You have to be ready for those moments, those lucky moments to cross your path, and you have to know, you have to seize them.
Yeah.
I think everyone has them in life, and you just have to jump on them. And but anyway,
you recognize them first.
You have to recognize them, and you have to, you know, you have to jump on them.
Yeah.
And in 1994, when InvestCorp took control of the company was in such bad financial shape that they weren't even looking at me. They didn't care what I designed. You know, whatever, fine. Tom's here, great. Well, whatever. You know, it was. So I had this moment to basically do whatever I wanted and do what I thought was right, and I took it.
Yeah, and you were handling about 11 product lines at that time.
We do still have 11 product lines, yes.
And so you were designing all of them.
I had one assistant left who, you know, is great.
Yes.
And is still works with me and is amazing and is also a big key to, you know, the whole thing. I mean, has been there with me for a long time. But yeah.
When was the breakthrough for you at Gucci?
1995, I think. My first season, you know, on my own without, you know, really trying to figure out what I thought Gucci should be, wasn't such a success. It wasn't really the right thing. It took me, you know, a season to really think, you know, what should this be? And to get it moving.
Those who write about you say that what you did, and even people who wear the products say, what you did was this notion of retro design and giving it a modern look. What do they mean by that?
Retro. I mean, you know, I've been accused of being a retro designer, well, for the last 5 years at least. And, you know, all I can say is that I think as a fashion designer, what you have to do is try to be a part of your time. You have to keep your eyes open, look at everything that's happening around you. You have to sense it, and you have to become a part of it. And for whatever reason, I don't know whether it's because my generation grew up with all these television, you know, well, your generation too as well, but, you know, my generation's a little cynical, or at least I'm a little cynical, but most people I know, most of my friends are a little cynical, and it is retro to a certain extent. There certainly are retro influences, you know, that have happened cross-culturally, by the way. This is not just fashion. Anyway, I'm getting off the track. But you have to sort of sense this and then turn it into fashion, turn it into a thing. And that's what's been in the air for the last 5 years. And it hasn't just been in fashion. It's been in architecture. I mean, there's been a resurgence of mid-century modern architecture, furniture design. You know, you open a catalog today from any catalog company in the world, and there's a Womb chair, you know, a Saarinen table, an Eames chair. You know, so it wasn't just fashion. It's also happened in music, it's happened in art, it's happened in culture.
At what period that you know about are you most comfortable?
What period? What do you mean? What
well,
period in history?
Period in history. Would it be the 40s, the 50s,
no,
the 60s,
it would
the
probably
70s,
be the
80s?
60s and the 70s. And I think, and it's funny because older designers, older designers, but some other designers that are my contemporaries, not in age, but you know, have been heavily influenced by the 30s and the 40s.
Yeah.
And I think really most people are influenced throughout their life by their very first images of beauty. So as a child, I was born in the 60s. You know, the 60s and the 70s were when I very first started seeing women that I thought, wow, she looks amazing, or whoa, this is a great apartment, or this is really a beautiful table, or, you know, God, look at that car. And those images stick with you. They form the basis of your taste. And I think that it's very hard I mean, yeah, you could break out of it, and, you know, we can all love what happens in the 80s and the 90s, and I hope the next decade and the next decade and the next decade, but deep down inside, the aesthetics of that era that you came into the world in, I think you carry with you in some way. I mean, my first images of beauty, and most people's, are probably, you know, their mother bending over them in a crib, and you think, wow, she, you know, it's my mother, and it's, you know, or... Do you know what I mean?
I do, of course I do.
And, you know, other designers, Yves Saint Laurent, for example, I mean, much of what Yves Saint Laurent has always done has been very much about the 30s and the 40s, and I'm not trying to speak for him, which, by the way, the 70s were very much about the 30s and the 40s. You know, yes, I'm a retro designer, I suppose, but all of us living in the 90s have been and are, you know, we're looking back at the 70s, but the 70s we're looking back at the 30s, and the 30s we're looking, you know, it's about having a sense of history. Each time we put our own stamp on it. You know, the mod period of 1995 doesn't really look anything like the mod period of the early 60s. You'll never confuse the two when you look back 50 years from now in a book. You know, each generation, you take it and you twist it, you change it a little bit, and it's got a definite stamp of that era, that moment in time.
People who know you well say that you have this genius for understanding where pop culture is. Let's assume for the moment that's true.
Thank you. That's nice. Well, let's do it.
Where does it come from? I mean, does it come from you read all the time, you're out talking to people all the time, you somehow, part of your gift is that you are more alert to the stimuli that is out there?
It's a puzzle. You know, everything that's going to happen next, the clues for it are here now.
Exactly.
They're in our culture now. It's all happening now. What will prompt what happens next? So you just have to look for it. You have to make it your job to find it. You have to, luckily, and this is a horrible thing, but as a kid, my mother was always saying, you know, I'm so sick of you telling me you're bored. You know, you're bored. You know, but it's worked for me in a sense. I've made a career out of it because it's my job to become bored and tired of everything.
So you're looking for something else.
Yeah, because that's the first key, is knowing, you know what, I don't want to see this anymore. I'm really tired of this. All right, well, now what do I want to see? You know, I've been looking at blue, you know, gee, and you look at everything else, and all of a sudden yellow looks great to you. And you think, you know, that looks really good.
Because
that
looks great. Fresh, because it's new.
And because your eye's ready for it. Because, you know, the right thing at the right time is the right thing. The right thing at the wrong time is the wrong thing. So, you know, it's got to be the thing that people want before they know they want it. So to figure that out, you have to figure out what they don't want.
Okay, but how does that happen is really my question.
You try to look at everything, you try to see everything,
you
try to
read every magazine, you do all them.
Yeah, I mean, I get, you know, literally hundreds of magazines every, and I don't sit and read every article, I don't have time. You know, you skim them, it's like speed reading in a way, you're trying to just fill your brain
with
stuff.
And images connect and therefore they...
Yeah, you know, you try to fill your brain with stuff and then all of a sudden you think, God, I'm so sick of seeing this stuff, I don't want to see this anymore. And you throw it away and you think, well... What do I want to see now? What do I want to see? And that's when you have to look inside, and you have to, part of it is intuitive, and you have to think, I want to see this, and you know, you're putting yourself on the line.
There is a story about you that you sent some of your design assistants, said go into Target stores.
That's true.
Go into Target stores and see what makes you laugh, and see what grabs your attention. And figure out why. And
how did
figure
you hear
out
that story? How did you hear that story?
Well, we talked to those
people.
That's
really wild.
And then figure out what it is. They say, you said, what it is that makes you laugh, and then how do we convert it into fashion?
Well, what this actually was for our home collection, our gift department. And, I mean, you can find your inspiration anywhere. You know, I mean, you can find it anywhere.
What happens then? Suppose you're inspired. I mean, let's go back to fashion, women's clothes. And
Target, by the way, and all those kinds of stores fascinate me endlessly.
Me too.
Because, of course, in Europe, we don't have those. And
well, they're coming, though.
Time
I mean,
Europe,
Walmart's coming,
coming,
I know.
No, they're coming. But it's usually one of the first things I do when I get to America is to go to some giant, you know, supermarket or thing. And just, I'm just stunned by, and it changes so fast. You know, I'm here, you know, once a month, but it even moves that quickly, you know. And
the genius of those people was that not only the genius of those people was the fact that they computerized early. They knew what was selling. They knew as soon as it was going off the racks. They figured it out at the end of the day or during the day and were able to either to order that which was hot, not order any more of the stuff that was not hot, and then keep looking and keep replenishing. I mean, the speed of delivery between the marketplace, you know, and the creation has just gotten tighter and tighter and tighter.
And more and more important.
And more and more important. What is it that you do when all these ideas are there? I mean, you sit at design meetings and say, okay, we got handbags, we got shoes, we got dresses, we We got home furnishings. We got whatever. And we got a responsibility to either satisfy the consumer or lead the consumer.
Yes, that's basically what I do. But it's not quite as dry as that. You know, I have, I mean, are you asking me, like, what is my daily...
Right. What is your day?
What, what is my day? Okay. My day varies from day to day. But a normal week would maybe be an easier thing. Maybe 2 days of that week I'm working on product. I go from product category to product category. I'll have shoes in the morning at, you know, 8, and then something else at 10, and something else at 11, and blah, 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 blah. And I move from category to category. I work with the design team. I say, look, I think we should do this. This really worked well last season. This didn't work. I'm tired of seeing this. Let's do that. Blah, blah, blah. I'll look at some things, change them. Let's see this in yellow. Let's see it in blue. Let's change the heel. Da, da, da. Go to the next product. The way we work, and I know it's hard. I'm probably not explaining this properly because, of course, for me, it's just second nature. The way we work is, you know, you have to be able to think of what you want to see. You have to be able to draw it or communicate it to someone who can make it. They then make it for you. They bring it back to you. You look at it. You change it. Perfect it. Send it back. It comes back. Send it back. It comes back. Send it back. It comes back 4 or 5 times until you have the finished product. Right. Once you have that, then you price it, you sell it, and then you manufacture it. Yeah. And sometimes you have to make some slight modifications to make it be easier to manufacture.
That's the
design part of it.
Here's what I'm getting at. We're going to see 3 minutes of your spring 2000 women's and men's collection.
Yes.
This took place recently.
Yes, spring. When was that? October for women's, actually end of September, and it would have been in July for men's.
Spring 2000. So
right.
It was July for you.
July for men's, September for women's.
All right. Take a look at this. Before we look at this, mm-hmm. When we see this, how many times do you see it on a model before it makes its way to the runway where the buyers and the fashion press see?
I fit and work on these clothes for 3 or 4 months before we actually start working on the show. Then when we're working on the show, for about 10 days, I try every possible combination because we show 50 outfits. I like to show a very short, concise thing. You have 20 minutes to convince the world of your way. And so it's concise. But there are hundreds of outfits behind these that are in the showroom that I, you know, you try this pant with that shirt, you Polaroid it, you try that with that, you Polaroid it, you try that with that, you Polaroid it. You do this for days and for days. You know, this jacket's great, but it'd be better like this. Let's take the sleeves off. Let's make the sleeves skinny. This doesn't work because her legs need color. Let's get some colored legs. Let's raise her up. Now she's doing, let's change the shoe. Let's do, and you do this, and you Polaroid and Polaroid hundreds and hundreds of Polaroids. And then you think, all right, what is my message this season? What do I want to say? And you edit those Polaroids, just like you're editing a film, because you know, you need to get the audience in, boom. You have to hit them on those first 3 outfits. They have to know what you're all about that season. Then you have to take them through. You have to make them think, wow. You know, you have to, once you've sold them on your initial idea, then you have to show them the subtleties of it. You have to let them see the fabric. You have to let them see, you know, the cut, the shape, the color. And then you have to, you know, you sort of take them up like this. You do it with music as well. And then you have to finish with something equally strong that reinforces and drives home your idea. So it's something that's very choreographed and very worked out. Then you have fittings. Once you've done that and you've decided these are the 50 things I'm showing or 45 things I'm showing, you have the girls come up.
Yeah.
They try them on. You fit everything to them. You change them around because some people look good in some things and some people don't look good in some things. You fit everything. You make everything. I mean, then we rehearse them. We walk the girls. We videotape it. We film it. We look at it. You know, it's not, you know, a lot of people think you're just throwing clothes on girls back there and they're just coming out looking that way. It's not what happens.
The devil is in the details and the opportunities
Absolutely.
In the details. For you, the designer, is the great moment, the most exhilarating moment, when they walk on stage and you get the response and then you come on stage at the end, or is it way back earlier when you had the brilliant idea to do whatever it is you wanted to do, or whether you had the concept that that this is what spring 2000 is going to be for
it's
us?
It's both of those. The first moment usually happens at 3 in the morning with a box of cookies and a big bottle of Coke and my Walkman on,
yes.
And you think, yes, that's it. But you can be wrong. You can be totally wrong. The next moment, you know, after you've worked, you need to wake up the next morning. You think, what was I thinking? This is horrible. The next moment, you put the whole thing together. Yes, it's a great moment when you think, God, it worked. It absolutely worked. It was right. But it is so fleeting because literally the moment I turn my back and walk off, especially if it was a big hit, you think, now what am I going to do? You know, now what? So it's, you know, there are a lot of great moments. I mean, they're
and you do that for a bunch of products, not just women's fashion.
You do,
men's fashion.
But it's funny. No matter how hard you work, women's fashion, I have a friend who always says, you know, everyone judges you on the women's fashion. I mean, it is the most visible and changes the most. And really the whole worth of the brand, to a certain extent, hinges on the success of the women's collection. Even though most of our sales, for example, are done in handbags and shoes. Fashion is a big part of our business. But the real core of our sales is leather goods.
It's a kind of but
everyone
women's
judges.
Fashion is a defining
yes.
moment. Is this part of the reason that you that Yves Saint Laurent is such a hero for you?
Oh, Yves Saint Laurent really is responsible for the way that modern women dress, and it really hasn't changed. I mean, he really put women in pants, made women sexy in a modern way. I mean, women had worn pants before Yves Saint Laurent put them in a pantsuit, but not, you know, it hadn't really been accepted. And women wouldn't have worn pants in the evening and pants to the office. And, you know, really invented the way of modern dressing for women. And it hasn't changed so much since.
More about him in a minute. Roll tape. This is 3 minutes of Gucci's Spring 2000 Women's and Men's Collection. And if it has no video, we'll talk over it. Here it is. Why is black such a big deal?
Black. You know, for me, black is important because I like shape.
Right.
And when you have black, you've taken everything else away. Color can really distract you. Color can distract you.
Yeah. How important are the models in presenting this stuff?
Models are very important, but they're professionals, and you know, that's why they exist. They know how to walk, they know how to move, they have amazing bodies, beautiful faces, but more than that, they have a presence. And a good model, especially in a runway presentation, has a real presence. It's mm-hmm. like an actor. You have to project. You know, when they walk out on that runway, you know, you have to like think, wow.
Wow.
And that makes it easier because, of course, you know, any type of clothing looks better on someone that's beautiful. So it helps sell your product.
Who determines whether this collection we're seeing mm. is going to be successful? In the end, it's whether people buy.
In the end, it's
whether people buy. Who influences whether people buy?
Well, most of our business is done through our own stores, so our buyers control that. And I have had collections that were maybe not as strong in the press, maybe not my best press collection, but that have been the best sellers.
Why is
so
that?
In the end, well, it's because looking for two different things. As I just said, black continues to be one of our number one selling colors. Editorially, no one wants to shoot black right now. That's changing. I mean, we're selling more and more color and less black. What you see on the runway is sometimes an exaggerated, enhanced version of real life that gets the idea across. You may go in and buy something a little more basic, a little simpler, which would not get a good review on the runway because it wouldn't push fashion forward. It wouldn't move it forward. It wouldn't change the way people think about clothes. So they're not two different things. They work hand in hand, but there is a certain different side to what's successful editorially and what is successful in terms of sales. Although for us, our editorial things have consistently been some of the best sellers.
One of the trends that
because you try to create an icon for a season with that.
In New York, you're on Fifth Avenue.
Yes.
I mean, you're on 57th Street.
We're on 57th Street temporarily. We're renovating our store on Fifth Avenue.
Yeah. One of the things that I have noticed recently, and anybody who looks has noticed recently, is that all you see are these emporiums being built along Madison Avenue. Mm-hmm. And there are Armani stores and Gucci stores and Bonnetaron stores and Ralph Lauren has been up on Madison Avenue for a long time. What's that about? Is it that the merchandising and owning your own stores is crucial to what happens?
It's so important because you can control everything. You can control the experience of the customer from the moment they walk in the door. You can control it with the architecture, the person who opens the door, who greets them, the music, the kind of service they get, the way the product is presented, the way it goes into the box and gets tied up with a bow, the personal relationship that you develop with someone who's selling. And when you're selling luxury goods, that's very important. You know, the store managers in our stores send notes to all the clients. I mean, you know, you'll get a handwritten note. We've got a great suit for you, Mrs. Smith. You know, I know you like white. It just came in, blah, blah, blah. And you don't find that in the world today. I mean, that personal service is so important. So you can control all of that. And that's really why I think you see so many people taking back or so much of their business.
Tell me where you want to take Gucci, you and your business side.
Well, it's funny because obviously, I think about Gucci a lot. At this point, I'm thinking also about all the other brands that we're in the process of putting together. So I'm thinking of where we want to take Gucci Group, which is a bigger question than where we want to take Gucci. Gucci, I think, still has quite a bit that could be developed. I think our business can grow substantially. I'd like to just see each of our businesses really take more market share. That sounds like a horrible thing to say. But our men's business, for example, is one of our fastest growing businesses and yet is still not one of the biggest businesses, men's luxury businesses in the world, and I think it could be.
But what we see in the media business is
everything. It's a trend all over the world.
And what you see in the fashion business is the same thing. I mean, will we see more and more of that?
You will see more and more of it. The key to its success will be that the consumer doesn't perceive it, because the important thing will be that each of these brands have their own personality. That Gucci does not look like YSL. Gucci doesn't look like Yves Saint Laurent, or look like Sergio Rossi, or look like, you know, each of these brands needs to have their own personality. And if all of us, and by all of us I mean LVMH and Prada, and all of us can accomplish that, then it will all work.
The reason I ask you what your plans were for the company is that at some point, Tom Ford will say, I have reached a point where I no longer want to design. Mm-hmm. I want to be the guy that's going to make a different kind of decision. Mm-hmm. When will that come for you?
It won't come immediately. There's still too many things I want to do as a designer. But I don't think it'll come. You know, never say never, never pretend you know what's going to happen. I could sit here and tell you that it might happen in 5 years, and then in 5 years I'll think, what was I thinking? I love this. I'm going to keep doing it. But the business side, and when I say business, I don't necessarily mean the numbers side of it, but the strategy of the fashion business excites me and interests me a great deal and is more and more part of my day and more something that I'm interested in. And there will come a time when I'll think, you know, I don't want to compete with these 22-year-olds who really have a better pulse on what's happening in fashion. I don't want to be struggling, you know, at a certain age thinking, God, you know, is this right? Is this right? When really I should step back and should, you know, that will happen at some point.
What's the biggest, what's the toughest thing about what you do?
Oh, God, a lot of it's tough, but it is constantly coming up.
Looking for what's new.
I'll tell you what it is. You feel sometimes completely drained because you basically sell your personality to a certain extent. You know, I walk down the street sometimes and I see people with my haircut and my clothes. And I go into the Gucci store and I see my furniture because, you know, the furniture in the Gucci store came from my house. I thought, this is great. I love this look. We're going to do this. You know, this is going to be...
But you created that because Tom Ford is what you are selling. You are in the end of selling Tom Ford, even though your name is not a label name.
I'm selling a mix of Tom Ford and Gucci. But... You know, constantly you have to come up with these new things. So every day people come to you, what should we do next? What should we do next? What should we do next? What should we do next?
What's
this? What's that? What's that? And at the end of it all, you can feel almost like you've just been, you know, completely drained. And so that's the hardest thing, is to constantly excite yourself enough to come back and say, okay, this is next. You know, this is next. This is next. This is next. Because it's exhausting.
There is talk. You spend more and more time in Los Angeles.
I love Los Angeles.
What is it about Los Angeles that intrigues you?
Los Angeles, well, there are many things about Los Angeles that intrigue me, but it is really one of the only completely 20th century cities, and now we're about to leave the 20th century, so maybe that won't be as important, 20th century cities in the world. I love architecture. I think Los Angeles for residential architecture has got to be one of the most amazing cities. I mean, all the great 20th century architects were working and really are responsible for the way Los Angeles looks. Aside from that, the film and entertainment industry is centered in Los Angeles. And whether we all know it, I mean, what I do as a fashion designer may be important in influencing fashion, but the most important thing is what's coming out of Los Angeles. Because everything I do is filtered through. Everything everyone does in the world gets filtered through Los Angeles, or filtered through that business. You know, music videos, television, film, everyone working on all of those products.
But why, I know you believe that, but why isn't that as much true for New York? Because VH1 is here, MTV is here, and these television has much as powerful influence, if not more.
You've lived in New York a long time, and I lived here, well, for about 12 years at one point, but I've spent a lot of time in New York. And New York has become a very Los Angelesized in this big sense. No, really, the beauty standard, you know, the beauty standard in the world today is blonde streaks in your hair, you know, everything's all pushed up. It's a very LA beauty standard. I mean, in London, where I spend a lot of time, the women look more and more like women in Los Angeles, because Los Angeles is that filter that everything's going through, and then those images are being broadcast all over the world, and young girls everywhere are seeing, you know,
right,
these
but
girls.
Let me argue the point, though. But
you can
see
argue it, and we can argue it, and New York
because
is clearly
the fashion
important.
Magazines come out of New York.
It's true.
And
it's
those
true.
Are the magazines
and
where you see
And who is on the
picture.
Cover of all these fashion magazines lately?
Movie stars.
Exactly.
And the movie stars now, rather than models, are the most influential
exactly.
factor.
Exactly.
And those are the people that you, in a sense, trying to develop these cozy relationships
exactly.
with.
Exactly.
Like Rita Wilson, you mentioned.
And I love Rita, yes. She's wonderful.
You know, Tom Hanks, she's an actress,
right.
and Tom Hanks' wife.
Right.
And people like Madonna.
Yeah.
And people like...
So I'm not saying Los Angeles is responsible. I mean, to put, you know, in today's world, to attach any city to any, you know, media is a broad thing. It happens everywhere. It happens all over Europe. I mean, you know, New York is important. London is important. Paris is important.
But
it's
for you,
important.
Right now, it's Los Angeles.
Well, but that's a personal thing. As I said, I like the architecture.
Yeah.
I love Hollywood.
Yeah.
I love that. I mean,
what
I
is it you love
that,
about Hollywood?
That and people in Hollywood aren't going to like this, but I love, you know, it's on the edge of vulgarity.
Yes.
And I love that.
It's
and
tacky, you once said,
tacky
and gaudy.
And gaudy, but I love that. There's great beauty in tacky and gaudy.
Well, that's exactly part of what your success is. You found what the beauty was in tacky and gaudy.
Well, and one of the beautiful
Isn't
things
not?
About, yes, and one of the beautiful things about style in Los Angeles, or style more than Los Angeles, maybe style in Las Vegas,
yeah.
is that you have something that has been created by the people. You know, people come to these places to make their success. So when they make their success, they sort of shed the baggage of wherever they came from, and,
right.
and they take on, you know, I'm not explaining.
Yes, you are.
Well.
You're doing fine.
Anyway, create
anyway,
their own style, so to speak, which can be often quite original.
Yeah. Does that mean that the fashion business is moving more so to America than
no,
it is to Milan and from Milan and all those other places.
Certainly, American culture is really slowly taking over the world. And Europeans won't necessarily like that, but I mean, it's true.
And the French will like it least of all.
Least of all. But it's true. American culture, even if things are, you know, even if creative things are coming out of Europe, they're quite American style products. And by products, I mean even, you know, video and film and television and everything.
How much of the draw of Los Angeles is the fact that somehow in the back of Tom Ford's mind is that he may decide, having done everything that he can do at Gucci, both in terms of strategic planning and design and running a, you know, a multi-billion dollar company, what he would like to do now is to direct films, bring all of the sense of culture and style and feeling for the pulse of where young people are. Film.
I think film is the ultimate design project, and I did say one time I'd love to direct a film, and I probably shouldn't have said it because, of course, I have no experience directing.
No, no,
you know,
that's
I don't
the
know anything
point.
About it, but it's fascinating because what I do in terms of design, the
you have
creative
an agent
part,
from one of the largest agents.
He's a friend. He's not really my agent, Brian Ward, but anyway, he's a friend. He's a good personal friend, and I'm too busy to...
He's looking at projects for you. Come on.
No, but anyway, I'm quite involved in what I'm doing at the moment,
yeah.
and it's taking all my time. What was I going to say?
Well, you were going to say about directing at some point, because film is the ultimate medium for you.
Well, it's the ultimate design project, in a sense, and it lasts
music.
Forever.
It has music, it has
costumes,
it has
more than that. You design
it has
a world.
Design.
No, you design a world. You design these people. You design what they do, what they say, whether they live, whether they die. You design a little world that's locked in a bubble, and it can never change, and the ending is always the same, no matter how many times you watch that video. Nothing ever happens. You know, and living in Europe, I often come home at night, and you know, if I'm tired and I don't want to listen to French television or Italian television, I'll pop in a video, and boom, 1939, there's this world. You're laughing, you're responding to these people as if they were alive today. And that it lasts forever. It really is, so I think that must be very satisfying. Fashion is over the moment the woman leaves the room. And the next time you see this person in the same dress that excited you the very first time you saw it, it's not the same, you've seen it before. And you see it in a museum 20 years later and it's on a, you know, it doesn't capture the moment, because that's what it's about a moment, and it's very fleeting.
See, I can hear you in the future saying, all of my life has prepared me for this moment to direct a film. All the things that you have done, you could say, you know, you can always have cinematographers and others come with a good script. You can get involved in projects.
I would be something I'd be incredibly interested in, but not anything I'm interested in near future. I've made a commitment to being where I am. I love what I do, and there's still a lot to do here.
From a design standpoint, mm-hmm. where are we headed as we go into this next century?
Everything that we've done in the 90s is just, it's finished, it's over, and I really feel that. And I don't feel it just because we're hitting this year 2000, but you just feel the end of a cycle, and that's over. Where it's going next, I don't know yet, and I hope I figure that out. There are lots of directions fashion will go. As I said, it will depend on where life goes. It will depend on what's happening with the economy, because, you know, the rich are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer. And who knows? I mean, 50 years from now, we could be living in a world like the 18th century where fashion reaches absurd heights in small little pockets of civilized society, where you're, you know, jumping by plane from pocket to pocket, and in between is just, you know, a wasteland. I mean, who knows?
Are there moments in which you think, say to yourself, and there was, it is said, this story when you went back to your mother's or your grandmother's home mm-hmm. in Santa Fe, and you're just going through things that I had to do as well, you know, after my mother died, and you're realizing how many things that they had.
Oh, yeah.
Are there moments, building on that idea, in which you say, this is silly.
Oh, yeah.
This is all
there are a lot
silly.
Of moments where it makes me sick, the amount of stuff, the amount of things.
And all you're doing is creating a taste for more things,
and
more things.
I know. And you're right. And, you know, we may have a real backlash against all of this. And again, if we do, it will be because people still need things. You know, I still need a glass to hold this water in. And if it's a beautiful glass, it enhances my life because drinking out of it is a different experience than drinking out of a paper cup.
Sure is.
It is. It's different. It adds texture to your life. So we're still going to need these things. But there may be a real backlash. And we may become much more conscious of, you know, less waste. And if we do, and this sounds like a really sick thing to say, but it will be our job or the job of the luxury industry to adapt to that. You know, trends change, fashion changes. Right now we're in an extreme over-the-top mode. Clearly that's going to swing back, and we're going to have whatever the new version is of what happened in the early 90s after the stock crash in the 80s. It's sort of pared down. You know, I'm not saying we're going to that, because it'll be different this time. But clearly we will have that.
Who has influenced you the most? Did obviously your mother had a significant influence.
My mother, my grandma, my parents, my father. I mean, I had great, you know, as a kid growing up, like a lot of people probably, you think, oh God, you know, I hate this, I hate that, I'm not happy, I want this, I want to move to New York, I don't want to live here in Santa Fe, New Mexico, you know, I want this, I want that. Looking back at it, I had the most amazing childhood. I had probably one of the most perfect childhoods of anyone I know. I had two parents that loved me and supported anything that I wanted to do and really gave me so much. And everything I have in life I owe to them and to what they, you know, instilled
in me.
What
they made you believe in yourself or gave you confidence?
They gave me so much. They gave me, you know, a moral sense. And by moral, I don't mean anything to do with sexual or, you know, I'm talking about sort of a real sort of solid sense of myself as a person. They gave me confidence. They taught me how to treat other people and to, you know, how to react with other people and what was important in life. And I mean, I think about things that, you know, I can hear them. It's like a broken record in my head often, but I had a wonderful childhood. And that, you know, I am so lucky, and a lot of people don't have that. And it gave me a foundation.
You weren't an athlete in high school.
By high school, I was an athlete. You know, by the time I was in the eighth grade, I became an athlete. Yeah, when I was younger, I had asthma. I was sort of, you know, I would rather stay home and rearrange the furniture than play football. It's true. By the time I was maybe 12 or 13, I was playing tennis and skiing a lot. I was on the ski team in high school and tennis team, and I was more athletic and had sort of whatever.
Do you ever dream that it would end up like this? Did you know? Did you sense that you would somehow make a difference?
Well, I don't know whether I've made a difference. That's, you know, doctors and...
Within your own realm.
People doing, you know, there are a lot of people doing more important things.
Well, that's, designing dresses. It's not a comparison. But, it's a confession.
Yeah, I felt an incredible sense of drive to accomplish something. Maybe it wasn't so focused as a kid. I didn't know exactly what it was going to be. I knew, you know, I wanted to do something. And I've always had a great sense of drive.
Even Nobel laureates who've come to this program, not one has said, the reason I achieved so much was because I was smarter than everybody else.
Mm-mm.
They all say it was because I had drive, energy, and wanted it more.
And maybe I was naive, become, maybe I'm still naive, you know, that ability to say, oh, I can do that, you know, sometimes it's quite foolish. And if you're smart, you think, I can't do that. I don't know anything about that. What the hell, what am I thinking? But that drive can, you know, it's drive, as you just said. I mean, the drive can sort of overcome that, and you can learn and figure it out. Things that you might looking, that's why I think, you know, so many people, it's your, oh, this sounds silly, I'm not even going to say
it. No, say it.
Well, I was going to say it's your youth, but of course, clearly I'm still in my youth. But even looking back now at what I was doing in my 20s, I'm not sure I would have had the strength now to do some of the things that I did earlier on, because I was kind of stupid and naive. And had I not, you know, had I really known what I was getting into, I would have said,
or if you knew,
you know, you shouldn't do this. And probably 20 years from now, I hope I'll look back even at now and say the same thing.
You have said, I mean, it, you know, it made, you've been announced that you were a gay man for the press, and have a relationship with a journalist that lives in Paris. But you have said, and you have said that if I chose 10 words to describe me, gay would not be one of them.
It wouldn't be. And, you know, I don't even think about it. It's not even a question of gay and straight. It's just who I am. I don't even think about it.
What 10 words would come to mind when you would describe yourself?
Oh, God, probably overbearing and
driven.
You know, driven and, you know, lots of things. But that isn't, and I hope that one day the world will be that way, you know. I mean, you meet people every day in your life, you know, you meet men, you meet women. You don't want to sleep with all of them, you don't want to have a relationship with all of them. They're really people. And what you want to do is connect with them as a person. And so for me, it's just not even an issue. I really don't even think about it.
You find it's an issue in your business at all?
No, it's not an issue at all, and it's not an issue in the world that I live in. I never encounter, I never even think about it. Sometimes when I'm in a place, you know, not a major city, I will all of a sudden realize, oh, you know, people think that, you know, that that's not okay, or, you know, and it's a shock to me always, because in the world that I live in, I don't even think about it. It's not even an issue.
Let me come back to where your company is going. Any news that you can make here with me today about?
No, I'm sorry. I wish there was, Charlie. I know what you're asking, but I can't.
There's nothing that you're going to buy, either
nothing
in terms of buying back some stock that somebody in the company. Nothing you can tell me
about
without getting in trouble with the board of directors.
Well, or maybe even bigger boards than that, but no, nothing I can tell you about.
Or is there something happening that I might want to know about?
You might want to know about it,
yeah.
But as I said, I can't.
But
really
it's fair to say. It's fair to say.
We're very actively pursuing lots of different options, yeah. We still have $2 billion to invest.
Because you used about, what, $900 million or $1 billion
on about a billion.
YSL.
Yeah.
Right. So you've got $2 billion to invest, and you're looking for investment.
And we're looking for smart ways to invest it.
It's great to have you here.
Thank you very much.
You.
It was great to be here.
Tom Ford from Gucci for the hour. Thank you for joining us. See you next time.
Where can you find millions of books online? BarnesandNoble.com.
Over 70 million people are getting an education
on the internet this year.
Are you ready?
Virtually all internet traffic travels across the systems of one company, Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
DLJ Direct is proud to underwrite Charlie Rose.
DLJ Direct, the thinking of a Wall Street investment bank combined with the speed of the internet. Donaldson, Lufkin, and Jenrette, putting our reputation online.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.
Politicians,
business leaders,
scientists,
authors,
artists,
the people who do know,
the people you should know,
tonight
on Charlie Rose.
Sets, call 1-800-ALL-NEW.